Hi everyone, and welcome back to Endangered AI, where we do AI tutorials, AI news, and everything AI. Today is the first video in a series designed to help you master animation in Stable Diffusion. By the end of this series, I hope you'll have the knowledge, skills, and tools to go from making animations like this to making animations like this. Although we'll be starting this series in ComfyUI, we'll also be covering it in Automatic 11.11. I also wanted to invite you guys over to our Discord, where you can come, hang out, ask questions, show off your artwork, and in general, hang out with other AI enthusiasts. Please don't forget to check it out in the link below. And with that, let's get started. As you can see, I've split the workflow into three key areas: the basics, the Animate Diff nodes, and the case sampler and output nodes. By the way, if you're new to Stable Diffusion, I suggest that you start with this video here, where we go through some basic workflows to get you started. If you are familiar with Stable Diffusion, you'll note that there are only three key nodes we need to pay attention to. One, the Animate Diff Loader. Two, the Context Options. And three, the Video Combine node. These nodes can be accessed through the Animate Diff Evolve node collection and the Video Helper suite. You'll find the links to these resources in the description section below, and you can also find them in the ComfyUI Manager. Now, before getting into specifics, it's important for you to grasp the basics of animation. Anything that you watch on a screen, be it a YouTube video, TV show, or a movie, is essentially a sequence of images played rapidly enough that your eyes perceive it as motion. In Stable Diffusion, when we talk about animation, we're essentially creating a bunch of images and stitching it together to create an animation. And this is where Animate Diff comes into play. It uses a motion or animation model in combination with your chosen Stable Diffusion model. The animation model helps make sure that the Stable Diffusion model is generating one image after another in a sequence, rather than taking a bunch of random seeds and ending up with images that have nothing to do with each other.
Simply put, Animate Diff uses an animation or motion model to condition the sampler to generate images or frames to follow a specific motion based on the conditions provided, whether it's a prompt or a control net. This is why we have model variants for specific camera motions, such as the V2, pan, tilt, etc. These models are trained on the movements in various situations. Personally though, unless you need these movements for specific animation, in general, I prefer to use version 3. On top of that, we can train our own animation models to be used in this particular node using Motion Director, which allows us to get really fine-tuned animations, something that I'll cover in a later video. Now that we've covered the basics of animation, we can have a look at the workflow, starting with the basic section. Here, there shouldn't be anything that you haven't seen before, with the positive and negative prompts over here, as well as the checkpoint loader for the checkpoint that we're going to be using to drive the animation. The only important thing here that you need to note regarding animation is, instead of using the regular latent image that we would normally use for an image, we're using empty latent image big batch. And what this does is it will submit to the case sampler the number of images defined in batch size to be the animation. In other words, the batch size is the number of frames you're telling the case sampler to generate. We can also set the width and height. In this case, I have it set to 768 by 768, which is the upper limits of what Stable Diffusion 1.5 can do. Then we can slide on over to the Animate Diff nodes, where we're going to start with the Animate Diff Loader legacy node. And the first thing here is the model name, where we set the animation model that we're going to be using to drive the image model. In this case, we've got the motion model version 2, and you'll also be able to select whatever other models that you've got installed. On this particular machine, I have V3. Next, we have the beta scheduler. This setting is pivotal as it determines how Animate Diff processes the images. Different schedulers are tailored for different model types. For example, the Stable Diffusion XL scheduler is compatible only with the Stable Diffusion XL model. Generally though, you'll want to use a linear one, and for Stable Diffusion 1.5, we have three options available to us. The next parameter is motion. This one is quite straightforward. Higher numbers give more animations, lower numbers produce more subtle effects. If your animations start to look too psychedelic or distorted, adjusting the motion setting can help maintain balance. I'm not 100% sure, but I believe this basically determines how different one image is from the previous one. Less of a difference means that there's less chance of distortion, but also less animation. You also want to avoid going above 1. 1 is equivalent to about 100% animation. Apply V2 models properly. This applies additional parameters relating to the V2 models. I could not find much information on it, but I imagine it has something to do with the motion loras. Now let's talk about the context options node. This node is extremely important, as understanding it can take you from this to this. The node comes in different flavors, but today we're going to be using the looped uniform node. The first three parameters, context length, context stride, and context overlap, are interlinked and have to do with, as the name implies, maintaining stability and context throughout your animation. To understand how to manipulate these, we first need to understand that the Animate Diff models are trained on 512 images at 16 frames. This means we typically won't change the context length because this will start to do funny things to your animations, much like using the wrong size on a Stable Diffusion model. But, you might ask, if the model can only understand 16 frames of context, how am I producing these long, smooth, and relatively stable animations? To achieve this, Animate Diff has a cool little trick called sliding context windows. Just because the model only performs well with a 16-frame context window doesn't mean we can't have multiple overlapping context windows to drive better stability. On Cosyncoding's GitHub, there are animated illustrations explaining various settings. I will also place a copy of these with their explanations on my website and Patreon if you want to check them out. So if we look at a couple of these configurations to understand them, we can begin to grasp how stride and overlap can affect your animation. If we ignore context stride for now and examine only context overlap, in this example we have it set to 4. If the animation has 64 frames and a context window of 16, this means that after the first 16 frames are generated, it will use the last 14 frames, in this case 25% of the 16 generated frames in the first batch, as conditioning to drive the rest of the frames in the new 16-frame context window. This means that for every 16 frames, it will actually only generate 12 new ones, as it's using the 4 frames from the previous batch of 16 to drive context. Thus, the greater the context window you use, the longer your animation will take to generate. Now, this is usually a good place to start. However, you might find that sometimes elements change drastically between context windows. A background might warp, an outfit might change drastically, and you might find that even an 8-frame context window can still give you janky results, with massive changes between context windows. This is where context stride can shine. Context stride causes the model to do additional passes over your animation to try and improve context between context windows. And as you can see in this illustration, with a context stride of 2, the additional passes actually skip frames to try and maximize the amount of animation that it's looking at, while still keeping it to 16 frames. This allows the model to see more and fix continuity issues in your animation. It's not perfect, but in some cases I have seen massive improvements. The major downside, however, is that using context stride can drastically increase your generation time. Beyond this, you can leave the remaining settings, as these are a little more advanced and we will cover them in a later video, as they're not required to get you basic quality animations. So now that we've covered the Animate Diff nodes, let's examine the Video Combine node. This is where individual images are processed and once ready come together to form your animation. The Save Image node, as you've noticed, holds a series of images. Video Combine seamlessly takes all of these images and blends them into a fluid animation. So let's break down the key components of Video Combine. First, we have frame rate. This sets the speed at which your images transition, essentially defining the smoothness of your animation. The magic number for basic fluid motion is around 24 frames per second. It's actually technically slightly less, but we're rounding up for simplicity. Higher frame rates means smoother animations, faster image transitions, and of course, as a result, you need more images to have longer animations. Loop count. If you're creating a looping animation, here you can decide how many times the animation will repeat before it's considered finished. File name. This one is self-explanatory. This is where you name your animations. Ping pong. This setting determines if the animation will reach the end and then reverse back towards the beginning. It will keep doing this based on the number of loops that you tell it to do. So the difference between having ping pong on or off and using loop count is, if let's say the loop count is 3, but ping pong is off, the animation will go to the end and then start from the beginning. Whereas with ping pong, it will go to the end, reverse back, and then start again. CRF. This is about the quality of your output video. A lower CRF value means higher quality and a larger file size, whereas a higher value reduces quality and file size. This, of course, varies by codec, but for a visually lossless output, aim for about 20. Save metadata. This includes the workflow data in your output video, allowing for easy reloading by simply dragging and dropping the video onto your workflow. Format. This one is crucially important. The default is set to GIF, which is fine initially. However, as you refine your video, consider switching to formats like H.264 or H.265 MP4. These formats support more colors and longer clips, enhancing the overall quality of your animation.
Now that we understand the key nodes, we can begin to go from a stuttery mess like this to a smoother animation like this. I hope you found this video helpful. If you did, please don't forget to like and subscribe. And don't forget to come and check us out on Discord. I'd love to see some of the animations that you've created as a result of this tutorial, and we have a great community ready to answer questions and help you out with any problems you might have. And if you really want to support the channel, please don't forget to check out the Patreon. Your support makes it easier for me to make these videos. And thanks to these guys here, whom thanks to your amazing support, I'm able to continue making these videos. On top of supporting me, you'll also get access to exclusive workflows, a dedicated section on Discord, and early access to tutorial videos. Thanks, and I'll catch you guys on the next one.